Actually, this participatory element provides a fantastic link to the forthcoming exhibition at the Whitechapel entitled The Spirit of Utopia that will start, I think, on the 2nd of July and until early September. And that includes not one artist from Latin America, but two, particularly Pedro Reyes with his sanatorium and Julieta Aranda, a younger Mexican artist. And I guess you're going to talk to us about this as well as the pioneering years of Latin American exhibitions at the Whitechapel Gallery.
Thank you very much. I was really excited by this invitation because it gave me an opportunity to look back and to understand the foundations that have been laid in Britain for an event like Pinter. And I think it's interesting to remember that in really only in the last 10 or 20 years there's been a huge proliferation of art spaces and a giant art audience has emerged in Britain. But actually, it wasn't so long ago when there were just a few pioneering spaces around the city that were really premiering work from artists from outside the NATO alliance. And what came as a surprise to me was that the first show that the Whitechapel Gallery presented was in fact in 1945, first slide please, and this is interesting, this exhibition marked the rescue of the British people by Brazilian painters. If you can imagine, 1945, Britain was in ruins, the East End was devastated, and London was trying to recover from the effects of the Second World War. And it was the generosity of a group of Brazilian painters that helped us get ourselves back on our feet. And you can see here that the artists of Brazil donated 168 paintings, the proceeds of which went to the Royal Air Force Benevolent Fund. Isn't that extraordinary? So it was the first mark of a great and very generous partnership, I think. But I'm embarrassed to say it took some years after that before the Whitechapel Gallery really woke up not only to the phenomena of art across Latin America, but also some of its greatest individual proponents. However, in 1969, next slide please, something happened which benefited us enormously, and I'm sorry to say it was the closure of a gallery called Signals. And there were some very enlightened and pioneering individuals behind this gallery, one of whom was called Guy Brett, who was a critic for The Times. And yet, despite this very quite conservative but august newspaper representing really the establishment, he was one of the most radical figures in Britain. And he had, through another artist called David Medalla, discovered this young man from Brazil called Elio Oiticica. Signals Gallery immediately invited Oiticica to send works to them, which he promptly did. They arrived, they were received, and the Signals Gallery went bankrupt. In fact, the father of the owner of the gallery simply stopped funding it. So there was a whole body of work by this extraordinary young artist in London. Guy Brett picked up the phone to Brian Robertson, the then director of the Whitechapel, and said, "You've got to come and see this work." Brian did, and immediately agreed that this young man, who no one had ever heard of, should have a major exhibition at the Whitechapel. Now, Oiticica was, of course, a pioneer on many levels, because he refused to see this as an exhibition. And in fact, he insisted that it should be called the Whitechapel Experiment. He came after a lot of negotiation. Money was raised to bring him over to London. And in 1969, he came into the gallery and really inhabited it. And he created what was called Eden. And he writes of his experience. This, by the way, is a picture of the East End in 1969. It's so grim. I don't know if you can see this. Apologies for not having an image of it. And do pass this around. But it was a terrible place. And in this cold, grey, bleak environment, he decided to transform the Whitechapel Gallery into a room, his words. And inside this environment, he insisted, number two, that everybody should take their shoes off. Now, that's a very uncomfortable thing for us to do. It's very intimate. It makes us rather vulnerable. But it also makes us feel like we're entering a kind of domestic or indeed a play space. So he rewarded those who dared to take their shoes off by creating a number of different floors. Some were made of straw, some were made of sand. So you had different textures, different temperatures that you walked across. And then he enveloped the viewer in a series of nests, as he called them, nest stroke cells. And in these cells you could discover live parrots, tropical plants, an extraordinary range of sensuous delights, whole swathes of fabric with bright monochromes, and his famous parangole, the cloaks that he invited you to put on and to become a carnivalesque performer. And Oitisika was there every day in the gallery, treating the viewer as participants. Now, this was 1969, and of course we know in Europe at that time, in Paris, the Situationists and the, you know, the manning of the barricades, it was a time of tremendous ferment. But this was a different sensibility, in my opinion, and I think his use of colour, his use of synesthesia, his use of the traditions of dance that came out of the favela and of the carnival was something completely unknown and unseen in Britain at that time. The other thing was that he pioneered modernism, and modernism has never had much traction in Britain, let's face it. It's always been a very, quite a conservative culture. We have, you know, a very iconoclastic culture. We haven't embraced modernism, in my view, in the way that perhaps European countries have embraced it. So he also brought a love of Niemeyer, of the whole modernist aesthetic from Rio to cold, damp, you know, London in the East End. So it was a tremendously powerful and influential exhibition. Going on from there, it was, again, several decades later, in 1982, another radical move to women. Now, this may sound, you know, surprising today, but 20 years ago, in Britain, there were virtually no women exhibited at Tate. There were virtually no women in the collection of the Tate Gallery, and that was true, really, of most Western museums and exhibitions. But his work was about how they were being exploited by the bosses of the factories in which they worked. So there was a tension there. And in fact, quite a few of the women asked for their image to be removed. So it was a controversial moment in our history. Next, please. The 90s was a time when there was a real acceleration of partnerships with Latin America. There was a big show of work from Cuba. And this, I have to pause and say, as we were putting these images together, we realized that everything is on 35mm slide, and hands up, we haven't got around to digitalizing it. So this one image of Los Campanteros is all I can show you. We can't even find the catalog. In fact, I don't think there was one, so apologies for that. But what it cries out for, I think, is a big archival project where we need to digitalize all these images. Next, please. And then Guillermo Cuica, who showed for the first time a whole series of his works on mattresses, which are part of that movement in Latin America, which has been called cartografía, the way of mapping, which coincides with the notion of territory of the northern and southern hemispheres, of being, you know, marginalized, colonized, and the reclamation of territory and of history. Next, please. What we're also seeing is the gradual shift from exhibitions which are defined by nationality to the acceptance that Latin American artists are really part of the world stage. And this was a very important exhibition called Inside the Visible, curated by Kathy DeZega, which really recognized a whole body of work which was identified really by the fact it was made by women, but from all over the world, from Eastern Europe, from North and South America, from Britain. And so we, I think, see a shift away from these national surveys to simply acknowledging that there are powerful figures that are contemporary and must, cannot be ignored. Within that show, we had Anna Maria Marlina, next please, Gego, and of course, Lydia Clark. So, excuse me, this was an exhibition which moved between the historic and the contemporary. And it showed how there was a kind of area of work which, even though it wasn't directly feminist, was certainly defined by the conditions of being female. And it marked an important move, I think, in the history of feminism and in the theorization of a certain kind of area of practice. David Siqueiros, first ever big historical survey of this artist, came in 1997. And then Lines from Brazil, which was looking really at a very particular aesthetic movement in Brazil. Again, it included artists like Lucia Nogueira, who was then living in Britain, Adriana Barajo, and this is Tatiana Grinberg. Thank you. Again, a major survey, a retrospective of Francesco Toledo, came in 2000. And then the reprise of Oita Seca. I think it's true to say that it took nearly 40 years for his legacy to be really properly acknowledged. We must thank Catherine David, I think, for her championing of Oita Seca with a very important show at the Jeux de Pomme in Paris in the 90s, and then his inclusion at Documenta 9, I think it was. We decided to make this exhibition with partners in America at the New Museum. And this was a series of environments where the participant, again, was invited to submerge themselves in music tracks by Jimi Hendrix, in images of Marilyn Monroe juxtaposed with cocaine in balloons and hammocks. It was an extraordinary synesthetic experience, created 40 years ago, but utterly contemporary. Faces in the Crowd, again, a big exhibition which looked at whether you can trace modernist history of figuration. Can figurative art be radical? Yes, it can. And here, of course, was one of the greatest exponents, Eugenio Dickborn from Chile, whose male art is part of a conceptual tradition in Latin America, again, not seen in Britain before, although he had actually shown at the ICA, I believe, in 2000. Thank you. Inner World Outside was a different kind of focus on so-called outsider artists. And this is obviously a recurrent interest, particularly in this Venice Biennale. There's a huge sort of section devoted to this kind of work of people who are self-taught outside the margins of society. And this was, for us all, a remarkable discovery. Martin Ramirez, who really represents a different kind of aesthetic, which comes out of a different mental state, a different way of perceiving the world and consciousness. And then moving to the very recent present, Aloran Calzadilla, who are part of, I think, a very important new phenomenon in Latin America, which is moving image work. One of the big challenges, I think, for us all, as